Hey, what's up guys? In this video, we're going to do a little unboxing. And yes, you read that title correctly. This is the Smith & Wesson M&P R8 coming out of their performance center. Now, I've been lusting after this specific revolver for quite some time now, a couple of years, so I finally had the opportunity to acquire it, and here it is. So, without further ado, let's just check out this revolver and talk about it. So, here it is guys, the Smith & Wesson M&P R8. Now, this is a end frame. It's a scandium alloy end frame with an 8-shot cylinder. Now, just like the 586 L-Comp and the Pugnose, they scallop out some of the metal in the star extractor, as well as on the actual cylinder itself to assist in quicker moon clip reloads. So this cylinder is cut for moon clips. It does have a ball detent lockup right there, just like with a lot of the other Performance Center revolvers. And it has a 5-inch barrel with the integrated rail right there. Also, there's a tensioning screw up there, so let's hope that's all right, you know, just like the 325 Thunder Ranch. You guys know Smith's QC can be iffy at times, so let's just hope that doesn't get loose and the barrel shroud doesn't start moving. I believe the front sight is removable, but I'm not really sure on that. I think it's just like the 325 Thunder Ranch. So this is a very large revolver, as you can see. It's really big. It comes in at about 36 ounces. Does still have a stainless steel cylinder, stainless steel barrel shroud. But again, the frame is actually scandium alloy, so you cut some of the weight right there. So for being an end frame 8-shot revolver, 357 Magnum, that's not too bad. It's really not too bad. But it is still a hefty revolver, very large revolver. What am I going to be doing with this? Well, first off, I just want to take it to the range and blast a ton of rounds through this and have some fun. But I have some thoughts on using this as a home defense tool. Just because, guys, I've been, you know, running and gunning, practicing and training with a revolver since, you know, early 2015. And we're up to April 2016. So I'm very, very familiar with a double action revolver. Very confident. And I just feel good shooting a revolver. So I spent a ton of time with the revolver. So I figure you can use this as a home defense tool, definitely. You got 8 shots of 357 Magnum at your disposal. It's not too bad, not too shabby. Almost like a 1911. So that's what I'm thinking. I want to use it as a, you know, fun range gun, as well as it can be transitioned into a defensive weapon because I'm very used to a double action revolver. So definitely for a home defense tool. Now, this integrated light rail right here, you know, I'm still up on the fence about using a weapons mount light on a revolver, just like that. I'm trying to think it through, how to utilize this with a revolver, because you're just going to have to keep this light constantly on. You can't be manipulating this like this, moving, and then firing it with digits in front of that forcing cone, not a good thing. So, I had done a training class last year with the 325 Thunder Ranch, a dynamic class in low light situations, and I attached a light on that 325 Thunder Ranch, and the guy that was the instructor was kind of like, I don't know what you're going to do with that, because the drill required you to on, off, move, on, off, fire, you know, all this other, you know, all these things going on. So he just said, just keep the light on, you know, keep it on. So that was a different philosophy, I guess, to how to utilize a light on a revolver. So that's just something, you know, I'm going to have to think about. If you guys have any thoughts on that, let me know. I know a ton of guys out there were not too keen on having a light attached to a revolver. When I did those 325 Thunder Ranch videos, they were kind of like, what's the point of that, you know? And I kind of understood that because I'm used to basically carrying a 1911. I mean, that's how I trained, in holding a handheld light, moving, engaging the light, turning it off, engaging the light, turning off, moving, fire, engage the light, turn. So there was a lot of manipulation with the light rather than just keeping it constantly on. You know, so that's something I got to think about. You know, we'll think about that. Some people may ask, why did you pick the M&P R8 over the TRR8, which are, you know, they're almost identical. Well, some folklore here before I go on and talk about that, and I'm sure you guys have heard this all before, but the folklore, the story goes, the M&P R8, this specific model, was designed for a certain law enforcement agency. I guess the rumor was LAPD. Whatever agency approached Smith & Wesson, asked them to design and build a special purpose revolver for their SWAT team. Apparently, you know, SWAT teams have shield men, okay? They hold a ballistic shield, and that ballistic shield guy was holding a 1911. Alright, so you guys know pistols, the slide reciprocates. So apparently if the pistol was too close to that ballistic shield and they had discharged their weapon, the slide would hit up against that ballistic shield and cause a malfunction with their 1911. So with the revolver, you guys know there's nothing moving back and forth. So with the revolver, they can get that revolver up close and high and tight into that shield and still be able to discharge the weapon. Now, I don't know about that. I've seen training exercises with guys using ballistic shields, and most of the times their weapon is way out in front of that shield, all right, like a 1911. Yes, I've seen some weird, unorthodox ways of holding that shield and the way they're, you know, handling it and the way they're positioned. There's some really awkward positions, so maybe that's why. You know, I don't really know. So that's the story. Is it true? I don't really know. I mean, I have guys that attest to it because they're law enforcement officers that are on SWAT teams, but I cannot attest to their credentials. Smith themselves don't really confirm it either. but I have heard that certain agencies did evaluate this specific MNPR8 model for their SWAT teams. I don't know. That's just the folklore story. The reason why I picked the MNPR8 over the TRR8 is because I thought this looks cooler, number one. But mainly is because this rail is integrated into the barrel. That's what I liked about it. And with the 325 Thunder Ranch, as an example, it has a removable rail. Now, I did have that rail attached with three screws Loctited in. And what happened was, under recoil, no matter what, that rail still became loose. Now, that's very trivial. Maybe I'm doing something wrong. But I figure, hey, why not have the rail just integrated right into the barrel itself, so I don't run into that issue in the future if I, you know, decide. Because I wanted to have the rail permanently attached to the barrel. Just because I like the way it looks and stuff like that. And I could utilize a light on there eventually if I really wanted to. Also, I like the rear V-notch sight right there versus a square notch rear sight. The white dot front seems to just fall right into that V, and I like that. I could acquire that, you know, front sight very quickly. So that's just something else I liked about it. Other than that, cosmetically, you know, I had a, you know, the TRR8 has a little cutout there. They're practically the same revolver, basically, from everything that I've read about them. Smith told me they're exactly the same, just one was designed for law, well, I don't know if it was really designed for law enforcement use, but one of them was the, you know, concept gun for law enforcement. The other one is more of a recreational hunting revolver. So take it for what it's worth. So that's basically it. The only person I know that is using this revolver in the field is this armored car guard that I used to talk to here on YouTube. He carries the MNPR8. While he's delivering money, picking up money, he says he trusts his life to it. It's been ultra reliable. He's put hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of rounds through his MNPR8 without any issue. And mainly, he's been shooting 357 magnums out of it, specifically the critical duty 135 grain. That's his street load or his duty load. No problems. He carries 6 moon clips on the front of his duty belt. That must be a sight. And he doesn't feel undergunned. And he is a competition revolver shooter, so maybe that's why. But he loves the revolver. He's been carrying it for well over a year. He said it's been banged up, you know, in the truck on different things. The grip has been banged everywhere. He actually uses the Milt Sparks 200AW holster as his duty holster, which is very interesting to me. I'm not, because that's not really a retention holster per se with a thumb break. So I thought that was interesting, but I lost touch with him. I don't know what happened to him. So he attests to the quality and to its functionality and to its reliability. No flame cutting at the top strap after 1,000 rounds of 357 magnums. So that's good news, you know? So coming from him, I trust that guy because he did send me pictures of himself in uniform carrying this thing. It was kind of funny, and him holding it is kind of interesting. But so I know he's using it. So that's one person using a revolver out in the field, this specific revolver. So other than that, I guess, I don't know what else to say about this, guys. I guess just stay tuned. I'll be making more videos about this revolver. Just excited about it. I'll get this to the range. We'll do a range reflection hopefully soon. I don't know when I can get out to the public range at least. So we'll see what happens. And the trigger press on this revolver, you know, standard fare performance center. Tuned action. Very smooth. Very nice. You know, I don't shoot in single action, but pretty good lockup as any performance center. Just touch it and it go off. So not much to really talk about there. It's just a nice revolver. So I guess just stay tuned, guys, and we'll talk much more about this. And again, if you have any thoughts, comments, suggestions, leave them below. All right, guys, that's about it. So as always, stay safe and check 360 often. Later.